So our next speaker is the leader of the Liberal Party of the Yukon, Sandy Silver. You know the format? You want to use this mic or that mic or that one right there? All right. Okay. Sandy Silver, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you very much. Just going to get my computer started here. I'm not playing Angry Birds here. This is actually speech in here. I did want to begin by thanking Chief Fairclough for allowing us to be here on the traditional territory of the Little Sam and Carmack's First Nation. I'd also like to thank Chief Roberta Joseph for all of her guidance over her leadership in my now traditional territories up in Klondike. I've said this before, but Chief Roberta Joseph has been, Chief Joseph has been amazing in allowing me access to her government, every department, and we've had some great conversations over the years. And it's a good statement as to when you partner and open up dialogue, how important it is for the for me to do my job in the Legislative Assembly, knowing full well that that I'm getting first-hand information from the traditional territory of the Troniquachin. As MLA for the Klondike, I really appreciate that this year and in other years, this event is being held in rural Yukon. Many of you are leaders from rural Yukon and rural communities, and I know that you share this point of view that sometimes the roads are tilted a bit towards Whitehorse. As a rural MLA, I certainly understand your perspective on this, and I've tried to bring that approach to the Legislative Assembly. Rural Yukon is certainly a focus of Yukon Liberals. Too often we hear the conversation of Whitehorse or the communities. We're all communities. Whitehorse is a community. Dawson is a community. Pelly is a community. These are all communities, and they're all very distinct and all very different. I also want to thank Grand Chief Massey for her leadership over the years. We've had a lot of frank conversations over the years, and one thing that I really appreciated was there was never a time where her office was not open to dialogue. And I've grown and learned a lot as a leader from you, and I really thank you for that leadership. And again, I hope you, in your retirement, I know you're not going to retire, that's impossible, but in your so-called retirement, I hope you get a chance to enjoy yourself. We were in Paris together for COP21, and I know you didn't get a lot of chances to actually be in Paris because all the meetings were out by the airports, but so maybe you can get to go back to Paris and enjoy yourself there. But again, thank you very, very much for your leadership. I was able to spend some time last week in Dawson for National Aboriginal Day with Chief Joseph and with the Troniquachin and with CIS and others. I was very, very glad to share that important day with Troniquachin citizens. I hope all Yukoners took the opportunity to learn about the rich culture and the history of Aboriginal people in Yukon on that day, and also in every day, especially in our school systems. I had an opportunity last week to watch the residential school curriculum films that were now part of the Socials 10 curriculum across Yukon, and I'm extremely proud of Troniquachin drawing down on 17-7 and their hard work, kicking and screaming sometimes, to get residential school curriculum and First Hunt, First Fish, and other initiatives into the curriculum. I've said this before that the education department at Troniquachin is definitely firing on all cylinders right now. Also, previously getting J.J. Van Bibber's book, I Was Born Under a Spruce Tree, into this school system was something that I championed as an MLA. It's a small step as it's in the libraries right now. It needs to be in our classrooms. Aboriginal Day was also a great day to reflect on First Nations governments as stewards of the environment and of your continued vigilance and environmental stewardship. At the same time, it's a day to reflect on your contributions to our economy. As we see the focus from Government of Canada on infrastructure spending, the jobs that come with it as well, I see your governments as key partners in this program. We had a conversation with some of the economic development leaders of all of your communities, and we're talking hundreds of millions of dollars in equity from First Nations governments here in the Yukon. It's amazing. It's amazing the power that you have. And I just want to say thank you for allowing me access to economic development branches of your First Nations as well. By the time we hit June the 21st of next year, I hope to be standing beside Grand Chief Johnson, marking National Aboriginal Day as a statutory holiday. A Liberal government is committed to making this happen. First Nations, Yukon First Nations have led the country in so many ways, from the historic Together Today for Our Children Tomorrow to self-governing agreements and very, very much more. The Yukon is such a unique place in the world, and it's a place whose people, whose landscapes, whose experience, and whose history all shape our shared identities. Now, we believe that it takes us all together to truly move forward. The Yukon Liberals are committed to creating a territory where all voices are heard, where consultation means listening to those who live here and that know the land, and where we can all come together to the table, government to government, Yukoners to Yukoners, and lead together. I don't accept what I hear when I hear that there's always going to be controversy, no matter which party is involved in the top job, and that that somehow is the nature of the game. I had the honor to be here at the Little Sam and Carmack's First Nations GA last week, and there was an interesting conversation about lawyer-to-lawyer conversations and about how that's how it works. That seems to be how it works, that it's always going to be our side against their side. I disagree. It doesn't have to be that way. It could be leader-to-leaders having much more conversation and directing our lawyers together to interpret these legislations, either on a national basis or on a local basis. I think it's time for us to raise the bar, ladies and gentlemen. It's time to improve the bilateral relationships between Government of Yukon and the individual First Nations governments. And it's time to take the agreements that are in place out of the trunk and put them on the dashboard of the car. Put them in the driving seat. They are the roadmap. And they're not just the roadmap forward for First Nations. They're the roadmaps forward for all of us. And I think the place to talk about these agreements is at your leadership table. And I also think it's also at the Yukon Forum. These are avenues for rebuilding broken relationships and establishing strong new ones. A new Liberal government is committed to holding the Yukon Forum up to 4 times a year as it's laid out in the current legislation. A couple of times over the course of 5 years, that's just simply not good enough. Now, I know that a point of contention over the years has been Government of Yukon's insistence of setting the agenda unilaterally for that forum. Now, a Liberal government would set the agenda jointly with First Nations governments. The whole point of these conversations is to ensure that everybody's priorities are being discussed and debated. And so hopefully we can work together to have an agenda that is everybody's concerns. A Yukon Liberal government is also committed to holding the Yukon Forum within the first 30 days of holding office. We need to start right off the bat, tires hitting the road, government-to-government relationships right away. A meeting with all Yukon chiefs, premier, and cabinet ministers. There is no relationship that is more important than the one between the two levels of governments, period. And it's important to start by getting everybody in the room. I had a great chance to talk with Chief McGinty last week as well about having more opportunities to, as an individual premier, coming to the chief and councils and coming to your halls and to your boardrooms with nobody else but somebody to take notes and listen. These are just opportunities that we need to start thinking more about. Or we even talked about having First Nations coming into the Yukon Legislative Assembly and appearing and speaking. These are things that we need to start doing. If I'm successful later this year, I'm interested in attending leadership table as often as I'm invited. But of course, that is a decision that your organization would have to make. A Liberal government is committed to making changes in the Yukon Legislative Assembly, as I mentioned. It's well past the time to incorporate our First Nations culture in our seat of government, the Legislative Assembly. It's supposed to be a place where everybody feels at home, but I know that this is not the case because I've heard it repeatedly from First Nations people who come there. Now, that would involve all the members of the Legislative Assembly, representatives from First Nations governments and heritage departments to talk about this, and I'm totally open to the suggestions about how to proceed and how to set this process forward, but I am absolutely committed to making that happen. I'm also interested in improving the way legislation is created, particularly bills that have been that have direct impact on First Nations governments. I've been told by leaders in First Nations communities that a good example is the process that was used to rewrite the Children's Act. That was a much more cooperative model, and one that I'm extremely interested in pursuing in order to gather input on legislation. Another important relationship is the one between Yukon and Canada. I guess I was called a cheerleader today as far as relationships between Ottawa. You know, it's true, we have a great rapport with the current government in Ottawa, and I have had many conversations with many of the ministers, direct conversations about things that affect everybody at this table. That is for sure. That's true. And that is an asset. But we're not going to limit our relationship with Ottawa to a party that's red. It doesn't matter what political party is in Ottawa. We need to have a direct conversation and a positive conversation. And it would be great if governments from the Yukon could have a united voice when we talk to Ottawa, regardless of who Ottawa is and what Ottawa looks like. Now, these are all concrete things that I'm proposing today that will form part of the Liberal platform in the coming election. That important relationship between Yukon and Canada, I know the current government has already demonstrated its ability to work with Yukon First Nations priority items with its commitment to repeal Bill S6. Just quickly on S6, my team and my candidates that we're putting together, we believe in upholding agreements and not undermining them with unilateral amendments. Now, my very first conversation with Prime Minister Trudeau after the federal election, I stressed the importance of this item, and this was the number one thing on our priority list. I told him that it was first thing for the Yukons that he should, for Yukon people, that he should act on. And I'm very glad to see a bill has been introduced, and I hope it will be passed in this fall when the Parliament resumes. And I know that Indigenous Northern Affairs Minister Carolyn Bennett is very familiar with Yukon's issues and Yukon agreements. She has already been up here several times, as you know, and has begun work with her colleagues in keeping another commitment, and that is the inquiry into the tragedy of missing and murdered Aboriginal women. There has also been new federal initiatives on mental health and on education, which I'm extremely excited to see. And there has been a new emphasis from the federal government placing on its relationships with First Nations people. I had lots of great conversations with people that are in this room right now, because when the federal government says that's our number one priority, well, the onus is now on us. The onus is now on the people in this room to make sure that that work is done. And I talked to some people saying that's really hard. That's a lot of work. You know, we're already working very, very hard in the Yukon, and now we have this, it's an opportunity for sure, but a new pressure from Ottawa saying that we have to do better. And it's going to be hard, but we all need to work together as Yukoners to maximize the potential of that attention and therefore also the money that's going to come behind that. Now, I'd also know that our Member of Parliament, Larry Bagnall, is key in the processes that we're talking, and he's working very, very hard to make sure that your voice is heard in Ottawa. Now, we're still some time away from the election, but I want to give you some priority items already this morning, and I also want to speak as to how the Yukon Liberal Party would act as government. First and foremost, I believe that no party has a monopoly on good ideas. Good policy comes from good evidence, and good evidence can come from many, many sources. It can come from the left, and it can come from the right. It can come from miners. It can come from environmentalists, from teachers, from boardrooms, students, and everyday Yukon citizens of all backgrounds and all cultures. Yukon Liberals have set no limits on our sources, so long as it's important to the needs of the Yukon people and important to the economy and the environment, because that's how we base our decisions. We believe in making room with no limits, As Yukon Liberals, we're committed to civil discourse. We engage openly and honestly with all Yukoners, those who voted for us, those who didn't vote for us, and those who didn't vote at all. While sometimes this might mean disagreement, we believe that every point of view is part of the collective point of view of Yukon, and our decisions must reflect that. Our party hears from everybody. By making room for all Yukoners, there is absolutely no limit to what we can achieve in the Yukon. We have the world by the tail in the Yukon. We really do. We have amazing resources, including our people. We have water. We have pristine wilderness. We have a business sector that is amazing. We have got great people here. We should all be able to come together. We're a small population. We need to put partisan politics behind us. Now, we mean what we say as well. We as Liberals, we're careful about what we say, because when elected, we're going to do what we actually said we're going to do. When we say that we want to bring everybody into the tent, well, we're going to do that through the Yukon Forum and by working in partnership. When we say we'll restore civility to governance, well, we will do that first by reforming how we do our own jobs in the Legislative Assembly. We need to set an example. When I say that we want to improve relations with First Nations, we'll start by spending less time in front of judges and more time at tables like this one. Now, is there still room for respect? I mean, respect is probably one of the most overused words in politics. Does it mean anything anymore? Can Yukon First Nations be blamed if they have little left for governments? Can the private sector find a room for a little bit of it in the relationships that they've endured? Have disenfranchised voters abandoned it altogether? I learned a lesson a long time ago coming to the Yukon as a teacher. You need to earn respect. If you get up there in front of a classroom and just assume because you're a teacher and you have some piece of paper with a degree on it that you need to be respected or deserve respect, well, you are absolutely going to learn really quickly that you are not a good teacher. And it doesn't matter in education or in government. That is so true. You need to earn respect. And what I've learned teaching in rural communities in the Yukon is if you give this much respect, you get back this much. It's so true. It's absolutely true. People of the North want to be respected, and they want to be at that table. Through nonpartisanship, starting with question period, inclusivity as demonstrated by being receptive to First Nations concerns instead of shutting them off, and by return to civil discourse in the Legislative Assembly. As Yukon Liberals, we are not about setting limits. We're going to make room in the Legislative Assembly, and we're going to make room for trust. I got a lot more notes here, but I think I'm running out of time here, so I'm just going to, I could speak all day, but I'm not going to. I want to be also clear on two issues that CYFN and individual member nations have spoke out on in recent years, and I'll start with land use planning. Yukon Liberals believe in and respect democracy. We respect the land use planning process. We accept the will of an overwhelming majority of Yukoners and would implement the recommended Peel land use plan. Yukon Liberals also support evidence-based policymaking. We support a moratorium on fracking until more research is done and a better understanding of long-term effects is achieved. I am very receptive to First Nations concerns and will maintain an open-door policy as I have already as my time as leader of the Yukon Liberals. I don't operate with threats. I'm somebody who brings people together instead of driving them apart. Ask anybody who knows me. Divide and conquer politics is short-term goal-oriented. And that is not my style, and I am absolutely here for the long haul. So, again, thank you very much, everyone, for the opportunity to speak today. I hope I've given you some sense of our priorities as we come into the next election. I anticipate that CYFN will be hosting debates on Aboriginal issues during the campaign, and I certainly would attend that, and I hope the other leaders will be open to that debate. I guess we're going to have a little bit of one today is here as well, so that's great. So prepared for questions, and Masi Cho, Ganesh Jish, Choni Tan.